the noise, you'd speaking to people in front of you and you couldn't hear anything.
And they applauded us off in the end,
they did.
They?
Yeah, it was amazing.
Which I thought was good, actually.
Yeah, it was very good. He could do everything. He could head it, he was quick, he could find passes. He was just, when he was in the team, as a group, we always seemed to be a lot calmer. But to go to the San Siro, for me personally, in the knockout stages and lead him out was a night I'll never forget. Hi, everyone. Here we are for another episode of Off The Shelf with me, Michael Dawson, and my co-host, Paul Miles. How are you, mate?
I'm great, thank you, Dawes. Looking forward to this one. This is going to be a beauty, this one.
Oh, my goodness. I mean, my notes of this person is going to be so exciting, but he's running 5 minutes late.
Running 5 minutes late, unfortunately. And so the chair is there. How are you, mate? You good?
I'm very well, thank you. Yeah, all good. The sunshine is out in London. Not so sunny in Yorkshire, but there we go. I'm getting used to that. Yeah. But it won't be long until the summer is here.
You'd never tire of that view, though, right? And look, you've made it rain right
now. I've made it rain. I brought the rain with me. There we go.
Anyway, look.
I hope we brought our guest, more importantly.
I'll tell you what, this special guest is so special. I'm going to bring producer Matt. He's going to come in and tell us a bit more. In you come, Matt.
How are you? Yeah, all good. Look at us three on the pod together. What's going on?
Now, Dawes, there's a good reason why you're not in the presenter's chair.
There is. Very good reason, because as this is our 30th episode, it's a very special one. We thought we'd flip the script.
We were talking, weren't we? We were talking.
A little chat, without you included, Dawes. And we thought, you know what? It's about time we do a Michael Dawson episode of Off The Shelf. It's only right.
So we've done a This Is Your Life on you, and you, Michael Dawson, are this Off The Shelf.
Well, yeah. If I told you who I thought was coming on to this guest, wow. So you've done me an absolute kipper.
Absolute
you've done me a kipper.
Give us that.
In the bin with him.
You don't need that.
Unbelievable. Well, here we go.
It's a Dawes episode. You are our guest today.
Well, thank you for having me.
Oh, it's a pleasure to have
in a different seat.
I know. How's it feel being over there?
I don't know. I'll tell you in about half an hour.
I think we should do the basics.
I know. Listen.
324 appearances for Tottenham Hotspur between 2005 and 2014. Incredible defender.
Absolutely.
Formed one of our best modern day central defensive partnerships ever with his mate Ledley.
Yeah.
Took us into the Champions League in 2010. And then led us out to one of our greatest nights in European football when we beat AC Milan at the San Siro. This, and before I say another word, so popular with the fans, so popular with his teammates, so popular with everyone who works with him and is at the club. True modern day legend. Michael Dawson.
What a build up.
Absolutely. It's only right.
Thank you very much.
All very, very true words. Not a person at this club who's spoken about
no one's got a bad word to say about Dawes. No one.
Seriously.
No. Well, a few of the strikers he's played against probably have.
Yeah, but, maybe.
But there you go.
But top guy. There's a reason that we got you in to host this, Dawes, because energy, knowledge, but just love for this football club. You know, Michael Dawson, this is your life.
This is your life. Here we go.
And I know that for true because when he left us, I did his final interview, and that was quite an emotional moment. When
it was very emotional.
Starting to get the words out of you.
Very emotional. Very emotional.
Yeah. But we're not going to talk about that now. We're going to take it all the way back to that kid growing up in Yorkshire. Come on, Dawes, what was it like?
Special. Everything I would ever have dreamt of. Wouldn't have changed a thing of growing up in a little place called Leyburn in the Yorkshire Dales. Two older brothers, Andy and Kev. So I was the youngest of three. The one who got stuck in goal. Who always just tried to compete with him. And playing in the streets, kicking the ball against the garages. Probably causing chaos. Annoying the neighbours, annoying my mum and dad, which I go through now with my son, who plays football in the house, breaking things. And me and him get into trouble off my wife. But it's just young kid growing up doing something I always dreamed of
and
doing.
And you know full well you can't say to your lad, don't do that, because you did it yourself.
Do you know what? She said it the other night.
Lucky.
He was kicking the ball against the wall and I could hear it shaking. I went, Louis, stop kicking the ball against the wall. My wife Anna went, it's only what you did. I went, you're right.
You went,
but I can say stop.
Yeah. Exactly. Now, Dawes, you know that half the time what you've got written down on your iPad is either good or is terrible. I've done a great job or a terrible job. So what I've written down here is that your dad was once on the books of Manchester United. Is that true?
That is true. I followed in my dad's footsteps, I suppose. He was at Manchester United till the age of 16. He was a very, very good rugby player as well. And he actually broke his leg playing rugby. So unfortunately, his dream of becoming a player was out. He got released from Manchester United at 16. And then went out of the game and never played professionally. But thankfully for myself and two brothers, Andy and Kev, we sort of gained from his misfortune, I would say.
That must have been very important to all three of you lads when you were going into academies and going into football clubs, that your dad had that experience. He knew what you were, you know, obviously he encouraged you to do it, didn't he? But he knew what you were going to.
Yeah, I would always say as any parent, which I am now, my dad and my mum were fantastic growing up. They weren't the pushy parents. They never have been. And they let us just go and experience everything ourselves, you would say, because I stand there on a weekend and I watch my boy play and I listen to parents shouting and wanting to live their dreams in the kids' lives. I'm like, just let them go and play. And that's what my mum and dad did. And from the age of 8, you know, I think it was 9 actually, Andy signed for Nottingham Forest at 14. So he was 5 years above me, Kev was 2.5. And I just followed in their footsteps, grassroots football, playing for North Allerton Town, getting the opportunity to go to Nottingham. But they were there to always help and guide and run round like every parent does. And I've realised how hard it would have been for them growing up, because we're doing it now, me and my wife, with two kids. So it's challenging. But the opportunities they give us, they sacrificed. And they would never change it. And thankfully for all three of us, we went on to play professionally. Andy had a great career and played for Hull for a long, long time. I've seen the other side of football, where Kev went out the game at 23. And thankfully for me, I had a long career as well. So I've seen the upsides and downsides of what the football can certainly bring.
Take us back to North Allerton. What do you remember about when you were a kid? Obviously, football's in your family, so it probably is always something you always wanted to do. But when did you sort of realise, and we often ask this question, but when did you realise you probably could take it further?
Well, I was actually a goal scorer, believe it or not. And I remember scoring goals week in, week out. I always struck the ball, obviously, really, really well. All three of us had natural ability. That's it, you know, and that doesn't define making a professional footballer. I watch Sunday League and you go, that kid's got natural ability. The way the ball strike, the way they control it, the way they take it past a player. And I obviously had that. You don't realise that at the age of 6, 7, 8. You're just scoring goals on a regular basis. I remember going to Forest, as I say, 8 or 9, and we played Lincoln. I think we won 7. It was probably 7 or 8 aside, and I scored 5. You know, I was quick. All these things that probably the professional side I didn't really have. I must have lost pace and stopped scoring goals as I got older. But I gained these opportunities. But I don't think you ever realise you're going to be a professional footballer.
You just play, don't you? Right?
You just play. You play, and I just think now it's been made a big thing that every parent wants their kid to be a footballer. Yeah. It's like you see the limelight, you see the pound signs and everything like that. It probably was different for me growing up. It was just I had an opportunity, and thankfully I took it.
Yeah, of course. As you were a striker then, back in the day, were you always a tall guy? Were you always stronger than everybody else physically?
No. I was the quickest, as daft as it sounds, and it was probably, I think probably the age of 12 or 13, I remember going to Keele University, the Reebok tournament I think it was called. I went with Forest, we must have had loads of strikers, and I ended up playing centre-half, and you were talking about like having a rope along the back line and moving defence together. I think it was Pete Cooper at the time who said, right, I'm going to put you centre-half, and we played Aston Villa, and I never played centre-forward again.
Wow, that was it?
From the age of 12 or 13.
Did you? You obviously slipped into that naturally then, but at the time you're thinking, hang on a minute, as you always say, striker, that's the glory position right there. That's the headlines, they're the goals, they're the match winners.
Yeah, but probably thankful for Pete Cooper putting me centre half.
It probably took some convincing though, didn't you?
Do you know what? You probably put in a different position. I never thought I would probably be able to play there. Did I want to head the ball all the time? No. But that was turned into a centre half. And I remember Steve Wigley and Paul Hart coming to watch me at the age of 13, and I was a centre half, probably only playing 18 months. I was known from Andy, known from Kev, they'd already signed. And I remember the two big cheeses at the academy director petrifying me coming to watch. And thankfully they saw something in me and signed me at 14.
Obviously Andy had gone to Forest early, which would have been a great help. But you were, was it always going to be Forest, do you think?
Yeah.
For you?
From the age of eight, I became a Forest fan. From meeting Brian Clough, they did everything to sign Andy at 14. So put us as a family in a hotel, went into Brian Clough's office before a match day, the famous green shirt, jumper. We'd all gone into the club shop, got our Forest shirts, went down the tunnel. I remember meeting Roy Keane, Stuart Pearce, Mark Crosley, these kind of players. And I became a Forest fan from then. And once Andy'd signed, then Kev signed, and then ultimately I was always going to follow in their footsteps. I was the youngest of three, 5 years difference, always wanting to be like them two.
Yeah, of course. For you then, going through the academy, knowing that your brothers had gone through the same sort of stuff, what was life like for you back in the Forest Academy as a young kid?
It was a challenge at times. You know, growing up in Yorkshire, I used to run home from school at 4 o'clock. My mum would be at work. My dad would have got home, finished early on a Friday so he could cook tea. It'd be chips, pies and beans. Quick bath, put my Forest tracksuit on. Half an hour to Darlington train station. I remember I got the 5:35 train. Train changed at Derby, which was obviously Forest rival at the time, and I'd be there in a Forest tracksuit. And I got into Nottingham at 8:30. Players coming from all over the country on the train. Get to where we'd be staying on a Friday night. The minibus would pick us up. Train Saturday morning, play Sunday, back home. School on a Monday to Friday. No wonder I was no good at school. I shot up by the time I got home.
Not forgetting the milk round as well.
I did the milk round as well. Yeah, the milk round was in there up at 6:15 delivering milk. So I knew what was to come because I'd seen my two older brothers doing that. And then Andy left home at 16, went to into the youth team and then progressed into the first team, played. I think it was only two or three games and then went out on loan. So I always wanted to be like him. I wanted to leave home at 14. I wanted to go and do the dream of a footballer. And well, it certainly happened.
We know that one of your jobs at Forest was to clean David Johnson's boots, actually. And it is funny, isn't it, how football and life turns out when not only do you, obviously you play with David, but then you play with his son, you play with Brennan as well, and you're able to share those stories with him. Mm. It's mad, that. It's just the way football goes sometimes, isn't it?
It's so bizarre, you know, because I was a late developer at 14. I was growing. So you said, was I always quick? No, I wasn't always big. I grew at 14 to 16, so I really struggled, you know, doing the travelling, doing school, playing football. I was very fortunate to, you know, I'd get a scholarship. But then at 16, as soon as I left home and went in, within the space of, I think, 2 months, I'd done a pre-season. I was playing in the under-19s. And that was my first year. So I'd had a really, really good first year. I'd cleaned Jono's boots, David. So that was part of your apprenticeship, doing them jobs. But Jono was great. Jono was incredible. He used to hammer me, but he'd always look after me on a Friday. Give me some money to fill up my Fiesta when I was 17. I had this little silver Fiesta, and Jono was unbelievable. So he was always one of them players that I always looked up to. He's Puma Kings. And then in my second year, I made my debut. So towards the end of that season, to get into the first team at 18, especially a centre-half, I was very, very lucky.
Walsall, what do you remember about
Walsall?
It?
Walsall, yeah, I remember it like it was, well, not yesterday, because it was a long, long time ago, but it was a little bit of a strange feeling because Andy had left by this time. He'd gone to Scunthorpe, was playing regular first team football there. And Kevin was 2.5 years above me, was a centre-half as well. So, me being the younger brother, Kev had been played a few games, was in the first team, got beat at the weekend, and it was Easter Monday. And the team hadn't been announced. I was in the squad, never played, and Paul Hart flips his chart over, and M Dawson's on the team sheet instead of K Dawson. And I was like, wow. My mum and dad were coming expecting either Kev to be involved or Kev to be starting, and it was me who ended up playing. So that was a strange feeling that I did Kev's place. We were a very close family growing up and even being in the academy and stuff like that. But to take his place must have been a little bit bizarre as a parent. Now your youngest son taking his position, and then he left in the summer and I just went from strength to strength in the next season.
Yeah, yeah. Did you ever get to play with each other?
We played in the reserves at Forest. No. Andy played with Kev in the academy and in the youth team. And the reserves, me and Kev played together in the reserves, but we never all three played together.
Shame, isn't it?
Real shame. There's 5 years difference, so it unfortunately never happened. But Kev, I remember walking off the pitch at the City Ground and just saying good luck. It was bizarre, and thinking now I'm living the dream, and I'm walking down there the tunnel at the City Ground, I'm going to make my debut, and he's sub your younger brother. Yeah. It can't have been easy for him.
Before we move on to talking about Spurs, your dad must have been so proud at this point, because all three of his boys have made it.
Yeah, and mum as well. It's probably strange. Like, now I'm a parent, I couldn't imagine going and watching Louis play football. I watch him on a Sunday morning in grassroots. And
Nottingham Forest as well, let's be fair.
Yeah, I can imagine it was a proud moment every time they came to watch, but I bet it was a nervous time as well watching them, because when I went to watch Andy when he was at Scunthorpe, I was still at school, and I used to love going and watching him in the first team football. I was thinking, yeah, it's my older brother. Just how it was. So is any parent watching their child do anything, football, you name
it. Can you imagine the way you threw himself into tackles as well? You'd be like, oh, yeah.
But anything, being a parent is a proud thing, anything. But to play professionally, it would have been good for them.
So you did so well at Forest, obviously, played alongside Des Walker as well. It's worth mentioning. I know he was a big influence on you, wasn't he?
And I didn't realise how he was at Spurs as a youngster.
I didn't realise that.
Des was a legend, and I was very fortunate. I know we always speak about Ledley, and I was very fortunate to have two senior people playing alongside. Des, when I was 18, he was 36 at the time, and we got to the playoffs, and Paul Hart was so hard on me. Wow. He was a tough taskmaster to get to them levels, but Des used to guide me. And it was funny because I played with Des, and I also played with his son, Tyler, as well, when I went back to Forest and Brennan. Yeah. So I think it was time when I realised I was getting a little bit older to hang the boots up. But yeah, and then obviously coming here and having Ledley, but Des was fantastic for me.
So, I mean, what people don't realise, because you've had those good years at Forest, I think you were in one of the PFA teams of the year, weren't you? And then you joined us January 2005, but you were only 21, Dawes. But I think people don't realise this. What was that like as a 21-year-old, moving from a big club in Forest, but now you're moving down to London, making that commitment and joining Spurs?
Yeah, I think I understand what players go through as an ex-player now. And all I knew was Nottingham Forest. That was the only club I'd been at. And then having to move from Nottingham to London, a long way from Yorkshire, where I'm going to walk into a Premier League club with world-class players. How are they going to take to me? How was I going to settle? The expectation of being bought, me and Reedy coming in. Reedy started the first game against Portsmouth, and I remember watching the game from the director's box at White Hart Lane thinking, wow, this is a big step up from the Championship, where I'd been so comfortable, I'd been talked about from the age of 18. I was going here, there and everywhere. And I'd picked up glandular fever at the end of my first season, which arguably for Forest was my best season when I was 18, just missing out on the playoff final after a red card, which every Forest fan will remember, against Sheffield United. So it was a challenge because I'd had injuries, I had a stress fracture when I came here. They were signing a lot of young players, but they were sending them out on loan. And I didn't want to be that player. I wanted to come here and try and have an impact, and I had to wait. But thankfully, when I got my opportunity 6 weeks later after I signed, probably very fortunate, because if I'd have been fit, they might have shipped me back on loan somewhere. Yeah. And we'd go to Anfield, and there was four or five centre-halves out. And I remember Martin Yall on the Friday going, Dawes, you ready to play? And I went, I don't know. Time will tell.
Yeah, I did.
You can imagine me. I'd been training. I always a little bit of advice I give to young players, train how you play. Because I probably caught Martin's eye. I was starting with Clive Allen and the under-21s or 23s, whichever it was. And I went up to train with the first team, and I trained how I played. Got tight, making blocks. And Martin probably thought, oh, not bad, this kid that we signed. And I got my opportunity to go and play at Anfield.
And the one thing you know about Martin is he wouldn't have even thought twice about putting you in either.
Well, he never had an option. No one else. So he was brilliant. You go to Anfield, and for me, I didn't feel the pressure then. I felt the excitement of walking out Anfield, great place, and never walk alone. My wife, mum and dad were there, drawing 2-2, Eric Edmond scoring that worldy goal.
Oh, yeah.
I got man of the match and played well. And never looked back. That was probably the start of probably where the fans went, we've got a good player, but you start setting the bar. I think I played 5 or 6 games towards the end of that season. And then the next season was when I really kicked on and was part of the first team, week in, week out with Ledley.
So Martin, you know, you had the trust of Martin. He put you in. Tell us a bit about Martin.
Oh, I love Martin. He was brilliant. He was probably the first manager that I looked at where we went on a Monday morning, we analysed games. In the Championship, we didn't really do that. It just wasn't the modern thing. I mean, every team does it now from down to League Two. So you'd either walk in on a Monday morning, go into the meeting room with your chest puffed out, or thinking, I'm going to sit in that chair and I'm going to get lower and lower because I've been involved in a goal that's gone in the back of the net. But he was just analysing it, trying to improve you. But it was hard. I found it hard that when I won, I was on cloud nine. When we lost, I was low. I'd take it home with me. It hurt me on a Sunday when you wake up and you'd lost a game. And generally, as a defender, you'd been involved in a goal that you could have probably done better and all these kind of things. But he was great. He showed an awful lot of faith in me, the team. We just started progressing. And obviously that season we just missed out on the Champions League on the final day. But he was a great guy, great manager. And he was a father figure to like a lot of people. He'd come on a pitch and he'd put his arm around you, he'd tell you when you'd done well. But he'd also let you know when you'd done bad as well.
Yeah, yeah. What about some of your teammates then that you walked into Spurs to meet? Because you came down with Reedy, as you said. So was that nice having someone that you already knew?
Yeah, I mean, I'd known Reedy for a long time. Reedy was, I think, a year or two above me. So he'd been into the academy, come from Ireland a lot sooner than I started. And he came in and got straight into the first team. So it was easy for him. For me, I'm on my own. I'm with the physios in the treatment room. So it was hard. But it's also nice having a face that you know, you have someone to chat to. But one player that went the extra mile for me was Robbie Keane. Okay. The first day I walked in from the Championship and he took me out for lunch. I'm thinking, this is Robbie Keane, absolute legend of the game. Yeah. Like, not just in the Premier League, worldwide. He was an icon. And that, for me, made me settle in. He was great, real character. I was on the receiving end of a few jokes on his behalf, but I didn't mind that. I was like part and parcel, and I always felt as though if they did that on you, they liked you. But Robbie was a big impact on me when I came in.
Look at that squad as well. I mean, you're right. I mean, this was a squad that was building, wasn't it? You think you look like, so Carrick was here, JJ, Jermaine Defoe, yeah. Keno was, you know, mid-20s probably by then. Mm-hmm. It was a team that you could see was building. And you were, obviously your arrival was an important part of that.
Yeah, I mean, I look at Spurs at that era when they were trying to sign young British, arguably. Like, Robbo had already come in, Keno was there, we had Michael Carrick from West Ham, Jermaine, and then in the summer Tom Huddleston came, Aaron Lennon, two players that I got very close to, when Routledge came in. So we had a group of young, we had a group of senior players that were combined really well together, on and off the field. We enjoyed ourselves, but I think we just had the spine of the team. You look at Robbo in goal, Ledley, Michael Carrick, and then you had Jermaine and Robbie, and then Crouch came in a few years later, JJ. Martin was putting a team together that was really challenging for not just the top 10, but top six. And obviously we haven't been doing that as a football club for many, many years. So I think I look back to where we are today, that could have been arguably the start of it, of where it got to. But yeah, we had a good group of senior players and young players coming through that were good players, but needed the opportunity in the Premier League, and we certainly took that.
Yeah, of course. Well, from your perspective as a centre-back coming into the club, you've already mentioned Ledley. We know he was a rock at the back and a big, big player in that Spurs team. What did you think about your chances of getting in front of some of the other players who were in that position? Like,
well, we had Naibet.
Naibet as well, yeah.
Anthony Gardner.
And Ledley talks massively about Naibet, by the way.
Yeah. He'd imagine him playing now. Obviously not the speed of the game, but the way he was so calm on the ball, starting possession, he used to stop the ball with the bottom of his foot and he'd just wave at people as if to go, where I can find you. Yeah. So we had some really, really good centre-halves. Callum Davenport came in as well. Yeah. So we had some good players. Mm. So for me, it was like, how am I going to get into that team? And I remember watching Ledley thinking, oh my goodness, this guy's an absolute Rolls Royce. And I still stay to this day. It's normally when he's beside me, so people think I say it because he's next to me. I wouldn't have had the Spurs career if I didn't have Ledley beside me. I honestly believe he was that good. We complemented each other really, really well. So having nose like this, I was probably the braver of the two, but he was a more elegant player. He could just play.
He was
arguably one of the best ever, and probably I didn't understand that before I came here. Mm. It's only when you see people on the training pitch and then you play alongside him, What a player, absolute gem, and as a guy as well. And we know he's normally next to me, but he's not today.
Pleaty always used to say to me when Ledley broke through and when he started playing centre-back, and you'll appreciate this more than anyone, just look at the way he just floats those little 30-yard passes into the midfield or into the front men. He said he's on point, left or right foot, with just as you want to build play, and just do everything.
He could do everything. He could head it, he was quick, he could find passes. He was just, when he was in the team, as a group, we always seemed to be a lot calmer. Yeah. You know, and Leddy wasn't the most vocal. There was people who were louder in the dressing room, but he just led by example. He was a real leader, and that's why you could see when he first broke in, he played in midfield at times. I have nothing but plaudits for that guy as a player and as a person for this football club that you can't say many players have only played for one club.
That's true. He's definitely an icon. And we always mention it, the mural that he's got on the high road. No one more deserving than Leds.
No, I mean, that must be a proud moment when it was finished. We went down, I went down with him, and I can't imagine driving up Tottenham High Road, which he does, and seeing yourself on a big, big wall. If anyone deserves it, Ledley deserves it.
Right, I'm going to take you back to a tricky day, as we would call it. So at the end of your first full season, 05-06, and we were challenging. And we were challenging for fourth, and we were challenging for Champions League. Everything was building, wasn't it? But we came to that final day of the season, and we looked in good nick, didn't we? So we were 2 points ahead of Arsenal on the final day of the season. We were going to West Ham. They had Wigan at home, I remember that. And everything just seemed there for us, and the day couldn't have ended worse. But you were there. So much has been said about this day. You were right in amongst it. I know you've spoken about it before, but just tell everyone now.
You said we looked in good nick. We didn't feel in good
nick. No. But I mean, we were in good form leading up to that game. So in normal circumstances.
Oh, we beat West Ham. We beat West Ham if we're feeling 100% fit. Guaranteed. And I'm not normally bullish like that. It was just bizarre. We went to a hotel on the Friday. It was a Sunday game, I think.
Yeah.
So we went to a hotel. Yeah. Oh, was it Saturday?
No, it was a Sunday.
Final day of the season. So we went, trained Saturday morning, went home, and then we drive back to the training ground, get on a bus and go to a hotel. Get to the hotel, you have your evening meal, no problem. Go back to your rooms, relax, big game tomorrow. And I remember 10 o'clock-ish, phoning my wife, thinking, I don't feel great here, but it's a final day, I have to play. Mm. Can't tell anyone, no problem. Right, love, I'm off to sleep, no problem. Wake up 12 o'clock, sick. Oh, no. And we've all been ill. If you're ill, you're drained. You're thinking, I'm going to run around tomorrow. Hot day. Got to maybe two in the morning, three in the morning, I don't know what time it was. Sick again. So now I'm starting to think, lying awake going, oh, I've played all season, my first full season. Done very, very well. I'm going to have to phone someone. So I phoned the physio at the time, and Charlotte was the doc. Come down and see me. I went, look, I've been really ill. I said, but I don't believe I'm going to be the only person ill here. As they're there, I'm being sick, nightmare. Anyway, what can we do? Go back to sleep, wake up in the morning. There's been a few of us ill. Disaster, what do? You know, can you play? And in hindsight, if I'd been a little bit older and a little bit more wise, I wouldn't have played, because someone who was feeling a lot better than I was would have done a better job. Police came to the hotel, checking everything. Said, right, we'll put the game back an hour. Said, what good's an hour going to do?
As if
I'm going to feel any better in an hour. So anyway, yeah, I think Michael Carrick came off early on in the game. There's quite a few of us who were ill. And I remember, I can still see the picture now of Ben Ayoun chopping inside at me in the second half and putting one in and lying on the floor. And I'm thinking, I'd rather be anywhere here than Upton Park. Mm-hmm. I just want to be in bed. Mm. It was a hard day, and it probably only took a couple of days to realise.
It's such a sad end to what had been a brilliant season.
What had happened, and missing out on Champions League in that way. And like I said, I don't believe we would have lost had we not had met so many people ill.
Tough day. Not too long after that, a marvellous day.
We had a few of them. Don't worry about that.
Marvellous day, your first goal. Yeah. A memorable one. Against Chelsea, and this was like a statement win at the time as well. Jose Mourinho's Chelsea were, well, no one beat him, did they? Let's be honest. But this was special.
It was. It'd been a long time coming, my first goal, and I was getting an awful lot of stick for it, by the way. Not the fact that I'd missed so many chances, just I didn't get my big head on it and put it in the back of the net. And when I did get that goal, I was just used to joke that, I was saving it for a big game, and I certainly did that. 1-0 down against Chelsea, and then I get us back to level pegging. Great, great ball in by JJ. I just had to get something on it. It was a slight glance in front of Didier Drogba. It was a handful. What a centre forward he was. And then Lenny, I remember Lenny's boots, yellow boots he wore in that game.
Did he?
Yellow boots, brand spankers they were. And I'm thinking, Lenny, you're brave. When the boots weren't that crazy then, that anyone wears anything now. And he chopped inside and put it in the middle of the goal and to win 2-1. But after a long, long time for Spurs to win it, beat Chelsea at White Hart Lane, it was certainly a special, special day. And the atmosphere, and one I never forget because it was rocking. And that, I think that showed the gap that we'd closed, because Chelsea, as you say, were winning Premier Leagues, were
superior. You could see that we were progressing, weren't we?
We were progressing. Yeah. Quicker than probably people expect with the players that we had, and certainly myself.
I must ask you about something. You mentioned atmosphere. I must ask you about... We were playing in Europe as well then, weren't we? So we'd gone back
first
into
trip.
Europe.
You're going to say about Besiktas, aren't you?
Besiktas.
Wow. Someone asked me that the other day, actually. What's the best atmosphere you played in? Besiktas was, wow. It was different. Mm. Like the tunnel you walk out and you've got fans there and you're thinking, wow, is this really safe? My first experience of European football, along with a lot of players. And we went there and we were magnificent.
We were incredible.
And the noise, you're speaking to people in front of you and you couldn't hear anything.
And they applauded us off in the end,
they
didn't
did. They? Yeah, it was amazing.
Which I thought was good, actually.
Yeah, it was very good. So that was hostile, but an experience, and stood us in good stead for the rest of our journeys.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, a moment, we talked about Chelsea, you scored your first goal. A few games later, you also captained the side against Chelsea in the FA Cup quarter-final. First time you won the
armband. What a big game as well.
Yeah, it'd have been better if we'd have won.
Yeah,
we were 2-0 up, I think, and Michael Ballack scored second half header. I can still see it now at Stamford Bridge. Mm. You know, and to get the armband was a real honour. I hadn't been at the football club too long, so I'd captained Forest at a young age, which was an honour, which I'd captained them pretty much every age. So Paul Hart gave me that. But when Martin Yule gave me it here, with the players that were in the dressing room, it was like, wow.
That's a big moment.
It was.
So
it,
early
it,
in your first career
yeah.
as well.
So obviously managers, when they give you that responsibility, I knew it was only going to be the odd game here or there when players weren't playing. Ledley was club captain. But I tell you what, it was a proud moment. Mm. But it'd have been even better if we could have held on. But we drew 2-2. And thankfully I went on to captain the team on many, many more occasions.
Did that give you an extra X percent when you pulled on that armband? Because you're a leader anyway.
Do you know what? It didn't really make a difference to me. And I wasn't one of them, even when I left here and went to, I didn't go in and go, I want the armband. It didn't really affect how I was. I said Ledley was pretty quiet. I could be the one who was shouting on the pitch or whatever. It wasn't about that. That's just who you are as a person. But it gives you a little bit more responsibility. You have different things to do off the pitch. But I was still only young then. That was early on to be captain at this football club. But it was always a proud moment.
What a game as well, FA Cup quarter final.
Yeah, I was going to say.
But... as we said, we were progressing. We were, all these, however disappointing that was, all these were building up to where we were going to get to, weren't we, basically?
Yeah.
And you were growing as a group as well at this time.
We were. We've been on a good journey, probably a little bit quicker than maybe people would have expected. But that when you get on a run, even when we went behind, we'd think we'd win a game. That I think it was 5-6 season, it might be. Yeah, 5-6. We'd go 1-0 behind and we knew we'd then go on and win the game. That's just how we were. We had players that could hurt, goal scorers in form. I think myself, Tom, Aaron, first year, certainly for myself in the Premier League, we played with no fear. And we just excelled. We really, really did. We got to a quarter final, as I say, but then just missed out on that day of at West Ham, but the year after, always in Europe again. All these days were building up to the group that we were building, and we were getting a lot of recognition from outside the football club.
I remember, we're going to move it on to January 2008. Not the obvious game here, and we played Arsenal in the semi-final. I remember the first leg at the Emirates was one of those occasions I thought, Team's getting there now. We deserve to win that one, didn't we?
Yeah.
This is before the obvious 5-1 back at the lane.
Yeah,
what was the feeling coming out of there? Because that was a massive game.
Yeah, and going to the Emirates was always hard. We had some tough games. But a semi-final, you go there, you know, it's two legs. We come away with a 1-1, could have arguably won, but we'd have took that before the game. Away from home, second leg at White Hart Lane. But I think we were quietly confident.
Just however, the way we played, though.
Yeah,
doors, right?
Yeah. I mean, that was where we were building to. That's where we'd got to. We never feared anyone. We really didn't. And I don't know if that was just because maybe we're getting into a territory that some of us had never been before. Excitement, the atmosphere, the buzz around the place. Everyone loved Martin. The fans were probably never been to that for a long, long time where we were expecting to get to. So it was great. And then obviously the build up to the semi-final. And that second leg was just mind-blowing. The way we came out the blocks.
The noise in that stadium that night.
That was one of the best. That felt like White Hart Lane, the roof was coming off. And you could feel your heart. It was like that loud. And to blow a North London rivals away, honestly.
Yeah, a slick five performance, wasn't it?
But we came out the block quick. Yeah. It was like, can you live? And that, as a away team, we've been on the receiving end of that. Teams come out quick. You're in the face. You take an early goal. Lenny, JJ, everyone was on the front foot. And we just blew them away. They couldn't live with them. We were far superior to them. And then to get the late goals to beat them 5-1. I mean, it wasn't as comfortable. It sounds like it was like that early on. It wasn't. It was in got a few goals in
we
the just,
we were clinical,
the last
though, weren't we?
We were clinical, but we were good. And that night was special to beat them, mm-hmm. and then get to a final, the first one as a group.
It's interesting about the mentality of the squad at this point, because as I say, you've been together for a few years now. You're growing. And I remember JJ saying, you know, in the days after that 5-1. You all getting together and saying, right, we have to win this now.
Well, we always used to get together when we'd done something good like that. It was worth a celebration. Of course it was. You've just got to a final, first time as this group. We'd achieved something, but we hadn't, because you haven't won it. Yeah. It was only the fact that we'd beat Arsenal and got to the final.
His point being, there's no point beating Arsenal 5-1 and then losing the final.
Exactly, because you don't remember losers. We still talk about 2008 when we won the cup. We don't talk about 2009, a year later when we got beat on penalties by Manchester United. So it's all about winning. And thankfully that day, Woody's goal come in. Hutz hadn't been in the club very long. We just had
Woody's
a group
third
of players.
Game, I think.
Is that what it was, Woody's
I
third
think
game?
Third
yeah.
One.
Oh,
yeah, it's really.
And Hutz will have been similar. And I think everyone who played in that game played the part for different reasons. You had Timu playing at left back for part of the game, Steed. Honestly, we had some unbelievable guys. And I think ultimately when we won that, we had Berbatov, who was as cool as a cucumber.
Penalty, yeah,
he was
course.
Probably the coolest man in the
man,
at Wembley taking that penalty. That's just how he was. We had a top class team, but we're coming up against Chelsea, yeah. who were favourites at the time. They'd been serial winners, had won the Premier League. We were the underdogs going in. But thankfully, what a day and what a few days it was after it as well. We certainly partied, that's for sure.
Yeah, of course. But before that, in the actual final itself, we know you didn't play in it. So from your perspective, what was it like having to sit out and watch the team do that without being on the pitch?
Must have been tough.
Yeah, it was one of my biggest regrets playing in a Spurs shirt. We 2 weeks before, I was on 4 bookings and we played against Manchester United. If I'd have got booked, I'd have got 5 bookings and I missed Derby a week later. So then I'd have been fit for the cup final. Anyway, I played well against Manchester United. I made some good tackles against Ronaldo down the right wing. I remember it. Come off the pitch that night, we'd had a good result, I think. So a week later, we're going to Derby. Week building up to Derby, we're doing sledges with Wando, some sprints. I felt my hamstring. So I said to the physio, let me get a scan. Because everyone's thinking, oh, you don't want to play, you're saving yourself for the cup final.
Okay,
ultimately, yeah. I didn't know if I was going to play in the cup final anyway.
Of course.
We had Eunice, we had Woody, myself. So who knows? I wasn't saving myself because I wasn't guaranteed. It was always going to be Ledley and one other. But in the build-up to the Derby game, and went for a scan and it was all clear. 10 minutes into the Derby game, hamstring gone, out for 6 weeks. So I miss a cup final. And whether I would have played, but just not to be involved and have my kit on and be there. Look, I still got a medal. I played in every game building up to the final, but I missed that. And I went to the hotel a few days before. I didn't go there. I had all my family down. I had like 25 people. We all could buy 25 tickets. So I took my allocation, had friends, family, everyone there. And it was a real disappointment, but it wasn't about me. It was about us as a group winning that. And as I said, we certainly had some party after that for a few days. It was great, and rightly so. We'd won the Carabao Cup, and it was a day that I'll never forget.
Now, things are about to change, because at the start of the next season, didn't go well, and Harry Redknapp came in the October of 2008, and Harry's here for the next sort of four years, and that group, your group of players, then takes us, you know, completes the journey, basically. What was it like when Harry came in?
It was a breath of fresh air. There was no hiding. I was struggling for confidence under Wander Ramos. Yeah, we were. I mean, we had 2 points from 8 games. And now I sit as a pundit and I look at teams that have 2 points from 8 games. You must be bad. It's true. And we weren't bad. We were just lacking confidence.
Yeah.
We really, really were. Individually, collectively, there was something not quite right. Players have to take responsibility. Ultimately, players get the manager of the sack because there's something not quite right. But I remember the meeting from Harry. We were in a hotel in Canary Wharf. And believe it or not, I'd actually got sent off at Stoke. I came on. I was going through such a bad time with
Wander. Game, by the way.
Oh, it was a bad game, I think.
That's when Gareth got sent off as well.
Gareth got sent off.
And we were getting peppered.
Oh, Hugo got... Gomez. Sorry, Gomez got carried off. I came on. Oh, it was just an absolute disaster. It was some hard times.
It was Stoke, wasn't it? It was Stoke on windy. Steroids game.
Yeah, it was windy. 8 minutes I'd been on the pitch and got sent off. But Harry came in, breath of fresh air, and he got me back playing to a level that I'd set under Martin. And then my form had gone away, confidence was shot to pieces. And this is why I can empathise with players that are going through that. I always say, if we could buy confidence, would pay an awful lot of money for it, mm-hmm. because I was shot to pieces. I thought I was out the door. I didn't think I had a future, but Harry came in, and that's why I owe so much to him. His management skills were magnificent, and I ended up personally getting in an England squad. We ended up getting to Champions League, semi-finals, FA Cup, albeit I slipped. But we were just in a way, and he had a great group of players, but we had a manager that could help us, and he certainly did that with his staff. What a guy and what a manager.
Looking at 9-10 doors, I mean, at the start of that season, I mean, I remember we went to Hull and Jermaine scored a hat-trick and we just looked in good nick. But was the feeling within that group, and we've been talking about this journey, so you've now been together for, 4 years. Was the feeling in that group at the start of that season, we can do something?
Well, the older guys when I came in were now really senior. Mm-hmm. They were probably middle of the age, 26, 27. So I was at that age now, and they were getting 29, 30. So you get into your peak and you get your old, now senior players where you should be expected to do well. You've learnt the game, you've been in and around things, you've seen the good, you've seen the bad. Mm-hmm. But when you've got a manager in charge with Harry, and to be fair to Harry, he must have walked in the dressing room and thought, I've managed some teams, but I've not managed a group of players that have got world-class players in your team. Mm-hmm. Match winners in your team. And you go through them. Gareth, yeah. Luca, Berbatov, Jermaine, Robbie. Mm-hmm. Oh, mate. JJ, Aaron Lennon, Tom. I mean, and he has managed some good teams. He's had some big players. But I'm talking about elite, world-class players. And there isn't many you can put in that bracket. Luca and Gaz, Berber. Wow. How do I get them playing?
We can actually tell Dawes a story here, can't we? When we had Crouchy on the podcast,
okay.
Right? Yeah. He told us a story about you were playing five. It was five a-sides, wasn't it? Mm-hmm. Five a-sides, and Crouchy wasn't involved, and he was stood on the sideline with Harry, watching. I think it was Luca, Gareth, Jermaine, Ledley, playing this five a-side, and Crouchy turned to Harry. Harry turned to Crouchy, and Harry just said to him, "This is a joke, isn't it?"
And we put Scotty Parker in there as well.
Yeah, of course.
The senior players, Harry brought in. I mean, we had an unbelievable squad.
David Bentley.
We really, really did. You can go through the span of the team and you can talk about your squad players, but everyone was involved. Yeah. And that came from Harry and Clive and Kev and Joe. But we just had a spirit. Mm. But spirit doesn't get you to the top. Good players get you to the top. Mm-hmm. It's like a manager. Harry had managed some good teams, but he's got this team now to a Champions League. And going to the Etihad that were paying an awful lot of money, that was a start where they were thinking they were expecting to be there. But we went there with no fear. Mm. We honestly believed we'd had some tough run of games going into it. And you're thinking, well, now you sit on the panel, you think, well, if they're going to get into the Champions League, they've got to beat X, Y, and Z. They deserve to be.
Yeah.
And we went and did that, going to the Etihad and beating them 1-0 with the Crouchy goal. I mean, we performed under pressure. Unbelievable.
Yeah, it was massive.
It was an incredible night.
What other highlights do you remember from that season? Because, I mean, you rightly mentioned the semi-final against Portsmouth, which was I know it was a massive disappointment for you. But you slipped over. You couldn't do anything about it. But I think it's important to remind people what people don't remember is that we then, after losing to Portsmouth in the semi-final of the FA Cup, we had to play Arsenal and Chelsea in the space of a week. And we're challenging for top four, defining games. And we came through both of those.
Yeah.
What can you remember about that little period?
Well, it was hard because I still to this day,
you want to play in an FA Cup final.
Yeah, I want to play in, yeah. And I remember watching that cup final. And I was in Dubai on my holidays thinking, if I hadn't slipped,
should have been
there. Yeah. Arguably, if our forward had scored a goal, we might have been all right in that day.
Yeah. Quick shift up.
Pass the buck somewhere else. But no, extra time and I slipped, and you have to live with those things. That's football. You've got to take the rough with the smooth at times. But like you say, the build-up to games going in there, we never feared anyone because we'd beat these teams after having the disappointment of the Portsmouth. And by the way, Harry was seething after that, because we were expected to turn up against a team that I think got relegated that year, and we underachieved, but we certainly got back to our ways. Did you say Chelsea? I think we
it was Chelsea and Arsenal. Obviously, yeah. The Arsenal was the Danny Rose, and then
Gomez, what a goal!
And then
what
Gomez
a goal.
Made his saves in the second half, right?
What a goal, Danny Rose! Who I now see very, very often on a school pickup in Yorkshire, and we've took up paddle, the pair of us with a few of us. Oh, so no, that goal, that
who would
goal,
have thought that?
Like, yeah. That goal when he scored
14 years on from there.
Yeah, I remember running past the front post, getting nowhere near the ball again. I think it was Lehman who punched it out, and Danny Rose, wow, in his debut, what a goal.
He probably heard
what,
it going through
what
the
what
air, didn't
what, honestly, whistled. I probably I've looked over my head. I've never seen the back a back net. What a strike. That's what dreams are made of. Yeah. So, yeah, we had a group of players. And Danny was with another one that was a young player coming through. He'd been brought
that was
in.
His debut.
Yeah. So we could certainly breed them.
Gareth was coming on then as well, wasn't he? I mean, he scored in, I think I'm right in saying he scored in both of those games. And I mean, he was just beginning to become the player that he became, basically.
Yeah. I mean, I knew Gaz from his time at Southampton, from watching the Championship. Andy was at Hull. And Gaz would be playing, and I'd be watching the Championship going, this is a young left-back who's the best player on the pitch. How does a left-back be the best player on the pitch? You know, we get a centre-forward, centre-midfielder, not a left back. He'd take free kicks, his delivery, and it took him time to settle in. It's not always easy.
He had some knocks as well, didn't he?
He did.
Injuries.
Yeah. I used to sit next to him in Chigwell. Great guy, lovely family, and you want people to do well. There was a lot of expectation on his shoulders coming through, and it's not easy as a young player. But
you all how young he was as well.
Yeah, and he looked young. Yeah. He really looked young. But his left foot, when you do sessions where you his delivery, honestly, was mind blowing. But to see where he got to, his physique changed, everything about him, and he was world class. I put him in for a period with Messi and Ronaldo. He was that good, honestly, mind blowing. And I looked to the 12-13 season when I was captain in the team then, and having a match winner in your team, someone world class, and people go, "You're a good player." Every player I played with in this Spurs team was a good player. Top player, but I'm talking world-class player. Like the playing in the park, pick the ball up outside your box and run past five players. This is Premier League. This ain't fun. This is Premier League football. And he was just unbelievable.
Without any excuse, I want to take you back to the Etihad. Because of the journey that you'd all been on to get to Champions League football, I know it meant so much to everyone, players, fans, everyone at the club. I mean, just that night, we were so good.
We were so good. And I don't think I'd realised, because I was so young when I came in, my first full season, we were then going for the Champions League. I don't think I realised the impact it would have on us until I'd been here a few years and now a regular first team player, and you go to the Etihad and what it can bring for the football club. Yeah. Your nights in the Champions League, that music. I was now a big part of the team, the success. But just to go there and play, I remember Harry putting Eunice in at right back, whipping the ball in, and Crouchy going there. But as I said, we weren't playing with any fear. And we believed we'd go there and win. It's weird how you look back and there was times I got nervous playing games. There's no hiding that. There was games I was going in, I wanted to do well, but I did get nervous. But this one, I just was no different. Didn't feel any different to what I normally did.
Yeah, and that's what's so funny is that when we've had people on this podcast, you guys have sat and chatted to most of them, but from Yunus Kabul to Crouchy, every single player from that team has said, we went to the Etihad and we expected to win. Yeah. We had no fear
of
belief. That Man City team. We genuinely believed that we were going to get the job
belief
done.
Belief and conviction that you were going to get the job done. Yeah.
Because we were a good team and we were playing full of confidence. And I think that's what just shows. We knew we had a group of players that were good players, but we had a group that was a team. And you won't win anything individually. That's fact, that's proven. You can't win a football match. There's no I in team, is there? So we collectively all over the pitch, we were strong, we were solid, and we had match winners. I mean, Lenny, for me, was mind-blowing. Mm. Aaron, the way he went past fullbacks, he got into positions, and you just think, wow, he twisted people up like you wouldn't believe. Crouchy was always an outlet, but his feet and his finishing, I mean, that was a tapping for Crouchy. It was great. But it was an amazing night, and then just to think that we're going to be in the Champions League next season.
Incredible, incredible.
So it must have been some celebrations that night.
Yeah, that night was good. unless Harry got a bit wet, didn't he?
He did.
He got a bit wet. So that was entertaining for everyone, unless it was Harry. But yeah, we're still
Where
looking
were
for Ben.
In that moment, though?
If you see the pitch, I'm stood back thinking, I ain't getting involved with this. I want to play next season.
yeah, as if that playoff was a problem, though, was it? 3-0 down.
Honestly,
that was I mean, the stadium that night. Yeah, and I'm thinking, we're done.
Like, I'd seen it a few years before with Everton, who'd qualified for the Champions League, or you think they have. The game comes to a playoff at the start of the next
and
season.
They played the Spanish.
And they went out. It could have been. Yeah. They went out, and all I could think was, yes, we've qualified in the summer, but we still have to qualify for the group stages.
Yeah.
And we go to Young Boys, AstroTurf pitch. Oh my gosh, I remember training the night before. There was no Ledley, no Aaron, because the knees, your different service and all those kind of
Jermaine
things.
Jermaine struggled on that as well, didn't he?
Three down.
Yeah.
Three down after half an hour.
Half an hour,
Bass scored just before half time. And then Pav, this hammer foot, got back 3-2 in the second half. I mean, what a hammer it was. We just, the pace of the game.
Yeah.
We just weren't ready for it. It was bizarre. And then later on, someone flew past me down the right-hand side and they could have gone 4-2 up in like injury time. Got away with it 3-2, come back to the White Hart Lane and beat them 5 and blew them away. Yeah, just showed the different surface. It wasn't like we underestimated them. I just think it was the fact that we weren't ready for the surface. Yeah, yeah, that's my excuse anyway.
Yeah, agreed. What was that what was that first season? I mean, we were fearless in this Champions League. We took that Man City night, for instance, we just took it into the Champions League, didn't we? Yeah, and but you know, obviously by then Rafa was here by then as well. And
yeah, of course.
The unknown, I would say.
Yeah.
Going to places, no fear, the unknown, and I missed quite a lot of the group stages.
Yeah, you had injury.
I picked. I think I was away in England, and I did my knee and my ankle, and I think Jermaine might have done it 2 days later. So I remember watching a lot of games, the group games from the stands and not travelling. I remember watching the Inter Milan game, having my tea at home, and then we were 4-0 down, thinking, thank goodness I'm having my tea at home. And then Gaz came. I believe that was the night that put him on the worldwide stage.
100%.
Not just for our fans and people in England, the worldwide stage.
Yeah.
He was absolutely sensational. Going into training the next morning, there was just a positivity around the place, and we got beat 4-3. It was like, it's irrelevant. We know we'll beat Inter when they come back to White Hart Lane. And Gaz carried on the form, blowing Mike on away, literally. It was like he had speed coming out of his feet. It was remarkable. And then to get to the knockout stage, it was just, for me personally coming back, but as the fans and the football club, probably one that people unexpected us to be at because of the group that we had. It was hard. But to go to the San Siro for me personally in the knockout stages and lead them out was a night I'll never forget.
Tell us about that night then, Dawes. So we're playing AC Milan in the round of 16. We'd been there, as you said, to play Inter Milan San Siro, but you weren't there that night. You walk out of the San Siro, you see those staircases, the turrets. If you've, you know, if fans have been there for the Milan games over the years, there's that stadium is iconic and then some, isn't it? What were you feeling personally when you walked out? I mean, you'd have seen it on the Tuesday night. Because we'd have trained
We trained, yeah. It was a tunnel that got me.
Oh, it's about a mile long.
It's a mile long, but the height of it is really low.
Oh, is it?
So when you're 6'3", you're not a million miles from the ceiling.
Yeah.
And I can still see that picture now, which I see very often if people want me to sign something. The players that we had in the team was incredible. And for me to be leading that group of players out was always an honour. But to go there against a team that, as I said, no one gives a chance. Go into the San Siro and to take the lead with a Crouchy goal. Lenny, again, like I've touched on, flying down the wing and then making the right decision and a finish from Crouchy. Wow, there's an upset on the cards here. And Zlatan Ibrahimovic, he scores late on. He nudged me over, I think. I think it was a little bit too strong for me in the end. But to hold on to a 1-0 win and the scenes after it was... Gattuso just showed that we rattled them and they expected to turn up, their fans, their players, and beat us.
Yeah, however, we didn't follow the script, did we?
We didn't follow the script. And that was the night the famous headbutt from Gattuso spat his dummy out and Pua Joe took the brunt of it. He didn't flinch though, did he, Joe?
Not an inch.
Of all the people to
honestly. Remember.
Joe Jordan and Gattuso. It's gone down in history.
It has gone down. Whenever I speak about that night, people always bring the Gattuso story up. And Joe ended up getting... got banned for the home game. He had to watch upstairs, Joe.
Oh. You know what triggered that, don't you? Was it a tackle on Sandro?
Or? Well, Firmino.
It was Flamini.
Flamini.
Right.
Right in front of the bench, wasn't it?
Right, towards the end. I mean, Sandro was magnificent.
How good was that night?
That night.
One of his best games in the space.
Yeah. And it just all went off. And by the way, I'm glad we had some big, big strong boys going down the tunnel after that. Sandro, Bassong.
Oh, yeah, Seb. Oh, yeah.
We had some guys who could look after you.
Michael Dawson.
I remember Sandro and Bass being in strong. Bass was a strong boy. Because it was a very, very tight tunnel, should I say, that night.
But obviously then we had to play him back at White Hart Lane. That was a edgy night, that with that goalless George Gomez played ever as well. Like, defensively, we were fantastic that night.
Yeah, and they'd still believe they could come to White Hart Lane and win, but we upset the apple cart again, didn't we? We defended well. Gomez, any game you play, your keeper's going to have to make saves, and that's what Gomez made, big saves in big games at vital times, and thankfully we got through.
Was that AC Milan one the pinnacle for you here at Spurs?
Probably looking back, you go... Champions League, last 16, we've beat AC Milan.
At the Sensi.
And you look at that team.
Yeah.
They were regulars in the Champions League to latter stages as well, by the way. Iconic players.
Yeah.
And to go there, it was certainly up there.
You look at Dawes's career here, and obviously 9 years. I mean, you played with some players here, Dawes. I just want to dig into a couple of other players. A player for me who I thought was so important in this team, Teemu.
On and off the field, by the way.
On and off the field. But Teemu, I mean, he's coaching now. Can you imagine him?
I can't imagine him coaching now. he was a real character. And he was probably, I wouldn't say most underrated player, but he gave more than what people would think. He was great in and around the dressing room, always a character, always positive, absolute class clown. A great guy, great, great guy. And I tell you what, when he played in midfield in front here, he'd break things up for you. Funny, funny character. That's all I can say. And one of the stories, I think, one of my first seasons, maybe it was... someone engagement party, I can't remember what it was. We'd all been out at the end of the season anyway. The next morning, I still don't know. You've probably heard this story. Still don't know why Martin Yol said, right, we're going to have a meeting tomorrow morning, 10:30. Season's finished. Everyone goes out, do what they want to do. Team who comes in a Spider-Man outfit. Honestly, that summed him up in a tee. Martin Yol went, I've got given you 6 weeks off now. If you're coming in like this, still half cut. But he was a real, real character and a good guy. And now he's gone into obviously coaching and management.
Yeah, and another player in the same position, funnily enough, who played, you know, a similar, you'd have seen all of his Spurs career, JJ.
Yeah, JJ, I knew JJ from his Forest days. He was always the one that everyone wanted to be like. Everyone spoke about being in the academy, a Nottingham boy. into the first team sooner than anyone else. JJ's a couple of years above me, but what a player. What a player. He could play. He played centre half for Forest Academy. He played centre midfield. He was class.
His technique was everything. Second to none.
But he was everything. Absolutely at his best when we won the League Cup, wasn't he? Because he scored at the Emirates. Yeah. He was involved. I think he was involved in every goal of the 5-1. Yeah. And then obviously centre midfield. I mean,
he was probably a player that the Spurs fans didn't really appreciate as much as they probably should have done for what he did for the team. His engine up and down. Yeah. He'd get on the ball, he'd try and start it, but then he'd nick goals. In both boxes, he was magnificent. Do you know what I mean? And he was one of them players.
He's very much like Pepe is now, isn't he?
Yeah.
The way he
glides around the pitch. Mm. Probably does the work that like a centre forward, if he comes short, he'll run in behind. A bit like Papa does, and I speak about him. He's incredible. Came from obviously Newcastle, which I'd already know JJ. He went up there, and when he came back to Nottingham, obviously, I was always thinking, he's the man.
What a player.
What a player.
Another player who has praised you, actually, in the past is Carlos Tevez. Now, he was once quoted as saying you were the best English defender they'd ever played against. Do you remember that at the time?
Yeah, he obviously didn't play against Ledley, did he? No, I do. And when a fellow pro singles you out, it's always nice. Even more someone like Carlos Tevez, because he was a top player.
Top
player. So even for him to know my name, I was quite happy. I must have kicked him a few times. That must have been the reason.
There's one constant in your career as a Spurs footballer was White Hart Lane. For fans who may not know too much about White Hart Lane, tell them about what that was like playing there.
It was all I knew as a Spurs player. It was the best for me. It was electric. I used to love going out the little tunnel, the old changing rooms, as you would say, and where we are. I didn't know the new stadium, but the atmosphere was electric every time. But I think for some away players, it would have been their favourite ground to come to. Yeah. I loved it. I really, really did. I loved coming back when I left. It was hard emotional to come back and play. And,
you had a couple of them, didn't you?
I did, yeah. A couple of losses as well, which is no surprise. But yeah, it was, White Hart Lane was all I knew as a Spurs player, and very, very special. And one that probably Spurs fans don't really know, that obviously the last game against Spurs, I'd actually just got relegated with Hull at the time, and we were playing at Crystal Palace. And I remember Daniel speaking to me saying, look, we'd like to invite you back. And it just wasn't right. I was employed by Hull City, and out of respect for them, it wasn't right for me to come back. We'd just been relegated, which is the worst can be for a football club and a player. So I missed the day when the rainbow's there, and the final game at White Hart Lane, and seeing all the ex players come back. Sad day for me, obviously not being able to be part of it, but one that I got relegated with Hull City.
Of course. I want to touch on something that you mentioned a little bit earlier, and that's your international career. Because you had a few caps for England, which is, you know, pinnacle of where any footballer coming through the game would love to play for their country. From your perspective, how would you describe your international career?
Short and sweet.
But it does include the World Cup as well.
It does include,
Exactly. I think it's underrated. If you look at the numbers and you say you got four caps, it's too easy to write that off as someone who never really was in and around the international setup and got the odd cap here and there. But you were actually a really important player domestically, and sometimes it just didn't work out with injuries or timing and that sort of thing.
I was actually in an awful lot of England squads. I think there's a book that Spurs fans wrote with every squad that a Spurs player's been in. And he told me one night, and I was in 32 squads, which was a surprise for me. I had some incredible centre-halves ahead of me, and there's no shame in saying I only got four caps. You look at Ledley, you look at Rio Ferdinand, you look at John Terry, you look at Jamie Carragher, and then you put Phil Jagielka in there, Gary Cahill, players that went on to get a lot of caps. So, I would have liked to have got more, of course I would, but for me to pull the three lines on my chest was a proud moment.
You still got your caps?
Still got my caps, they still got them, and thankfully I experienced going to a World Cup, something that I will never forget. It was an amazing golfing experience. One for the nation to be devastated that Rio got injured in the first training session over in South Africa, and I got the call. we'd been away on a training camp for 2 weeks. There were six centre halves in it. I think there was Ledley, Rio, John Terry, Jamie Carragher, Matthew Hooks and myself, cut down to five. I was the one that missed out, and then Rio got injured in the first training session. Whole nation devastated. Everyone who knows Michael Dawson delighted. I'm on the next plane to South Africa.
There we go.
Didn't kick a ball, but it was an unbelievable experience.
You're leaving Spurs. So I say, I spoke to you in the week of that, and you were very emotional. It had been a massive part of your life, hadn't you? But you just felt it was, you wanted to play, basically.
Yeah. It was a regret that I still have. But I played till 37. If I'd have stayed here for another 2 years, would I have played till 37? We haven't got a crystal ball. I always say this. So you make decisions, you've got to live by it. And at the time, I go back to the reason that I was sold. Maurizio had come in, but previously when Andre Villas-Boas came in, he looked to sell me. And I didn't play for 3 months. Eventually, I turned my fortune round with him. And I was 30 at the time when Maurizio came in, and they wanted to bring Fazio in, and they wanted me out the door. And it was just one of those timings that I could have quite easily sat on my bum and done nothing. My wife was pregnant. All these kind of factors came into wanting to play football. Chance to move north. But yeah, the day after I'd signed, I was thinking, I wish I could phone Daniel saying, can you send the money back and bring me back? It was like that. It was hard. Then got relegated, and it was an emotional time leaving here. I'd been here for 9.5 years. Mm. We'd come to this amazing training centre. A lot of factors played into it at that time, and as I say, one I sadly regret.
But you went on to have plenty more appearances in you. You mentioned going to Hull. Obviously, you ended up back at Forest. What was it like going back to Forest?
Yeah, I mean, my time at Hull, and my brother's a legend there, so they always, yeah. I was...
You won a playoff final.
Yeah, and I've got to touch on that because, you know, getting relegated was the worst day of my career, apart from any injury I had. I'd gone there, Hull signed me for, I think, £4 million at the time. They'd spent just under £50 million. So you're going in, and I'm one of those players that takes responsibility. I felt as though I'd let the club down. Arguably, it wasn't just me. I'd not too bad a season, but we got relegated. And that was the worst day of my career. It really, really was. But 12 months later, you talk about playing for England, walking out at the San Siro, winning the League Cup. I got promoted from the Championship, and I walked up at Wembley and lifted that trophy as a Hull player, and it was up there with one of my best days. Because I'd got back to the Premier League, where you think, will you ever play there again? Mm. But I'd still experienced that day of winning, and then going back after 4 years to the club where it all started.
Yeah, completed the circle.
Yeah, it was a perfect scenario at the age of 34 to go back, signed a 2-year contract. It didn't go quite to plan. 15 games in, I then get an injury. But the team that I'd supported, team that had started out and given me all the opportunities to then become a Premier League player where Hull bought me and where I had my best time. And ultimately fulfilled every kid's dream of playing for England, playing in the Champions League, winning a cup. And doing all the things you dream of.
By the time you were thinking about retirement, though, you'd already started getting involved in the punditry side of it, and we see you now on Soccer Saturday doing a great job.
No, thank you. Not everyone says that.
But how did... You're always great with us, always willing to front up, do interviews, so we always knew that you would be good in front of a camera. But when did how did you get involved in that?
So bizarre. When I was here, I finished my B licence. So my coaching was I going to go into with John McDermott. It was magnificent. And then I left it because my boy was born and I was travelling to Hull, an hour there, hour back every day. And then I got my A licence when I finished at Forest. But I fell into the punditry when I was at Hull, and David Prutton was a player I played with. He'd gone into the media, finished before... quite a few years before me. And I said, Put, you're doing great in the media. I'd love to give it a go. So the producer at the time was a big Spurs fan at Sky. Fell into it. I remember my first game I watched Swindon Scunthorpe. It was the worst game of football I've ever watched. Probably a bit like my commentary, to be honest. and I got the opportunity and then just gradually sort of kept getting asked back. And
there's one bit of punditry I do remember.
I remember that one as well. That's maybe why he got one. Got me the gig.
That was one guy you just couldn't
There was another one. Was it Harris Hedder?
Yeah, the emotions over there.
Yeah. I mean, look, I'm emotional when I get on there anyway. I'm watching football. It's something I love.
Yeah.
You know, it makes it a lot easier when we win. Of course it does. And the teams that I've played for, you're watching. But generally, you have to be neutral. You have to be. I'm watching a game, and I'll be honest, very much the same as when we lose a game. You can have an opinion. There's different ways of having that opinion. But that's just how I get a little bit too excited from time to time. I probably need to tone it down a little bit, but that's just who you are as a person. You can't change yourself.
Yeah, of course.
As well as punditry, you're back as a... Well, you're not back now, but a couple of years ago, you came back as a club ambassador as well.
Mm. Yeah.
Joining your old mate Ledley again.
Yeah.
I know this is you thoroughly enjoy this, don't you?
Yeah, I love it.
In the club.
Completely different. And when I speak to fans now, I go and do nights and things like that. And when I was a player, I couldn't be as... You can't be as open. And I say this to guys, look, it's not easy for players to go out and do public speaking because you're still a player. Your performance is to cross that white line and play. Now I don't do that. I can just be myself, have my opinion, can chat to people. I get on a train on a Friday night. I come and do my show on a soccer Saturday. You can mix, you can do different kind of things. And I think that's something that I've been very, very grateful for. One for Sky to give me the opportunity to do the punditry and one for the club to invite me back to be ambassador of a club that, you know, I love. My nephews are Spurs fans. Love coming to watch whenever they're north. I always phone in and buying tickets and things like that. So Spurs give me every opportunity to fulfil my dreams.
Of course. Obviously, doing this fantastic podcast, doing a brilliant job alongside Milesy hosting this. So massive credit to you. You've done a fantastic job post-football career in the media. You've done... Yeah, you've become the blueprint that everybody's going to now follow.
You've enjoyed talking to your old teammates, haven't you?
I love it, honestly. Yeah, and
hey,
I remember you phoning me, Matt, when you're going, are you going to do this podcast? I was like... Didn't know what I was letting myself in for.
Yeah, I know.
Completely out of my comfort zone, presenting it's something that probably not me, but when you're interviewing people that connect you with a football club, you know the stories, and it's just getting people to relax. That's when people open up and tell the best stories.
Yeah, well, you do a fantastic job at it. Absolutely brilliant. Couldn't think of a better person for me, Milesy.
Incredible.
Thank you very much.
So here we go, final question, and this is one that we ask a lot of people, so we're going to ask you the same.
Yeah, yeah.
We're
going to ask
you the seven questions.
No, this is not the seven questions. But it's the emotional question, Dawes. It's, look, 9 years as a player, all of those appearances, everything you did here, you're back as club ambassador, you're back on off the shelf. Michael Dawson, what does Tottenham Hotspur mean to you, my friend?
It means everything. I mean, it's given me the chance, as I've said, to play in the Premier League, to play for England, to lead the team out, and to give my family everything that they'll ever need. And you've got to be grateful for that. I'm grateful that they brought me back as ambassador, as presenter of Off the Shelf. So all these kind of things, I'll be forever grateful. And then that's in any walk of life, you need an opportunity. And when you get it, grab it with two hands. I say that when every debut I had for every club, give everything you can.
Brilliant. Well, it's been a pleasure. But as Dawes would say...
Yeah.
We're not letting you go yet.
Here we go.
We're not letting you go yet. We've got seven quick fire questions, as he would say.
Over to you, Milesy. Here we go.
Over to you, Milesy. Go on, take it away.
What's your favourite piece of football memorabilia?
I've got quite a few shirts, some good ones. But I think it's probably got to be my England caps. I could say my debut shirts. I've got every shirt. My debut shirts, England 1, Forest 1, Hull 1, Spurs, my two at Wembley, Carabao Cup ones that I didn't play and we still got them. Yeah. So I have quite a few shirts, but I think my England caps. I'd have liked a few more, but I've still got four of them.
That's a nice selection. Absolutely. Your favourite Spurs kit ever? I know where he's going with this.
Yeah, I mean, my first Kappa one, it used to be a bit tight, didn't it, that one? I'm not sure I'd want it on now. I have got the 125 year anniversary one, and that is framed. I mean, I had a disastrous game in it. We drew 4-4. Eunice gets the goal. So it'd probably be that one, I think. An Under Armour one was quite nice. I remember I scored against Reading in one, but I'm probably going to go safe with that.
Nice.
Next question is the best Spurs player you played with, in your opinion, and good luck on this one.
I mean, I've spoke about the players that I've played with, and I count myself very, very fortunate to have even been captain of this football club, but to play in the team and lead some of these players out. You look at Van der Vaart, you look at Davids, you look at Robbie Keane, you look at Jermaine Defoe, you look at Crouch, you look at Berbatov. I mean, Modric, Bale, Lennon, Huddleston, the king. But for me, the best player I played with, was that the question?
Yeah.
I mean, and the reason is because he could win a football match on his own, and that man is Gareth Bale, the best.
I thought it would be between Gareth and Ledley.
Yeah.
I thought Ledley might get the nod on his old mate Led.
Yeah, I know. I'm sure it'd be devastating. I mean, it's Ledley, everyone knows how highly I regard him. I mean, that name of list, and I probably missed some there, so I do apologise. But Gaz, what he went on to achieve at Real Madrid, I don't believe he was given the credit he deserves. Mm-hmm. For me, probably because it wasn't longevity, he was in the bracket of Messi, Ronaldo. Fact.
Top player.
Not for the longevity, can't but for
any,
a few years.
Can't give
and
him
that's
any
why I
credit.
say Gaz, but everyone I've named, honoured to play with him.
Can't give him any higher praise than that, really, can you?
Which leads us nicely into your Spurs five-a-side team.
Yeah, and good luck with this, by the way.
Because how many times has he asked this?
Well, he just reeled off that all those names.
Yeah, exactly. So I can't put them all in, can I? So,
good luck with that.
Hugo, Ledley, Bale, Modric. And my centre forward, would I have Modric in a five-a-side team?
Can you believe you just asked that question?
Oh, yes. No, but like,
do you know
what?
Why? Do you know why? So I'm even looking at Berbatov. But do you know why I'm going this player? Because he's ultimately just a goal scorer.
I know exactly where
you're
going.
I know where he's going, yeah.
And it was all about him. If he didn't score. And when he scored five, he'd want to score six. Whenever I trained against him, he was a nightmare. He was a right little, I can't say it on here. But what a player, what a goal scorer to play against Jermaine Defoe. In a five-a-side team, I mean, that team, Ledley and Hugo at the back, Bale could run or shoot and do what he wants. Luca just flicking it around the corner with the outside of his right foot, and then JD just putting it in the back of the net. All them centre-forwards I missed out, and the players I missed out.
Oh, too many.
Too many.
But that is unbelievable. There
you go. Okay, so your next question, and you can lean this into football as well if you want, but what is your piece of life advice As a father as well now?
I would always say, be the best you can be at whatever you can be, you know. And sometimes your best isn't good enough. I always say this to the kids, to players in the academy, in any walk of life. Not every academy player will make a professional footballer, but I have no regrets. Don't blame it on someone else. Just be the best you can be at whatever you do.
Love that. All right, final two questions. So, who is your Spurs unsung hero?
And it's going to be another midfielder, because this guy, not just at this football club, I think Sir Alex Ferguson, when he didn't pick him for a long while and then put him in the team, realised how good he was. And that man is Michael Carrick. Mm-hmm. What a player. Never got the recognition he deserved for England. Didn't get as many caps as he should have done. This boy was special. Mm-hmm. West Ham, I played with England under 21s. Great guy as well for me, looking up to. He was great when I settled in, living not a million miles away from me. So Michael Carrick for sure.
Oh, what a legend.
What a player. What a player. And to see what he went on to achieve, look, another player we lost, but Fergie certainly realised what a player he had.
He certainly did. Which leads us.
Final question.
Final question of the Michael Dawson episode.
In your opinion, who is the greatest Spurs player of all time?
So I've named Bale as the best player I've played with. I did play with Harry Kane, but I played with him only a handful of times. We look at Ledley King. He's in that bracket. But for me, the all-time leading goal scorer, who I only have praise for, is Harry Kane.
And you played against him as well, so you do know what it was like to be on the other side of that coin, if I'm not wrong.
I certainly do.
He had to get that one in.
Well, only because you said
But do you know what? I've got a story for you as well with this.
He won the golden boot that day.
No. He asked for my shirt when we swapped at Hull.
Did he?
Good.
And I've still got his shirt in my house.
Anyway.
What a way to end it.
I know.
What a way to end it, eh? Who cares? I'm back here now.
He's back here. It's all good. Life is good.
That was then. This is now.
been an absolute pleasure. Thank you so much, Dawes.
Cheers, Dawes.
Thank you for having me. Hi, everyone. This is Michael Dawson with Off The Shelf. Guess what? This was our 30th episode. We are done and dusted. We're going to take a little break, but we'll be back with bigger. I'm not going to say better, but plenty more guests.